money. Safe number one, show number one.
Hey, wow, man. Woo-hoo! Wow, this is it, pal. Hey, why don't you people wait for me, man? This woo-hoo, demonstrate. Wow, come on, man, lock arms. Come on, come on, come on, hurry up. Got my stuff for the tear gas. Wow. Hey, wow, look at the TV cameras, man. We're gonna be on television. Hope my mom sees me.
Why?
Just got out of prison, you know. Come on, man. Oink.
Unity, hey. Unity, together like...
Hold it.
What?
Where do you think you are?
The demonstration, man.
Oh, go wait, wait, wow. Wait, wait.
This isn't a demonstration. This is Jerry G and Company.
Company. I'm Jerry G. Bishop, and you are the company, and you are the company. And I thank you for being that company. I want you to meet a guy because always on the big TV shows, they never introduce the band. Jack, would you come in here, please? This is Jack Cecchini. All right. Hey. Jack. Jack is our, and we're very thrilled and happy to have him, really, our staff guitarist and an incredible musician. And these are the guys who, you know, accompany and never get any recognition. And before we go any further, Jack, give us a little demonstration. Play some blues for the, would you like to hear some blues, huh?
Yeah. Okay.
Now listen to this, sensational, go ahead. No, that's not what I, the blues, play the blues, Jack. No, Jack, that, I want you to play the blues. Can I show you what I mean?
Yeah.
The blues. Wait a minute. Don't get ahead of me. Blues moon.
I see.
You saw me standing alone. You get the picture?
Yeah.
Rotary Connection.
Sure.
Kiss your ring. Oh, get out of here.
The fabulous Rotary Connection, and we are old friends, really, and yet I have never asked any of you, and I'll ask Minnie, because she's prettier than you are, which isn't saying much.
If you thought I was pretty, you'd be in trouble.
I may be. Minnie, where does the name Rotary Connection come from? There's got to be an answer to this, and otherwise we're in big trouble up here.
You see, it was like this. So
I never thought of it that way. That's very logical. Is that how it happened, really?
And that's where it's at.
And that's how the whole thing was decided upon.
Really? Like,
you know what this is?
That's an album.
Would you hold that and show them? Take a nice shot of Minnie and the Ablum, and it is called Rotary Connection Songs, and I assume that there are songs.
A lot of songs on it.
Like?
Like, Burning
Written
the
right
Midnight
on there.
Lamp, Respect,
yes.
Sunshine of Your Love.
There is one that is going to become a new single,
Wait.
Right? The Wait?
This Town, things like that, yeah.
The Wait. Step out here. The brand new single from the Rotary Connection, it is The Wait, and it is The Wait, and we're on. Connection. The two characters you saw in our audience at the beginning of the show, the alleged protester and the guy who was cooling him down, really not protesting much. Actually, they're here to entertain us, as they are and have been recently at the Playboy Club and places like where around the country?
Well, we did the post-prom at Armour, Wisconsin.
Good.
And, well, I don't know what.
Supermarket openings.
Yeah. Boy, Sippy's next.
Yeah. Oh, really? Yeah. You ready?
On the Rat River. It's beautiful.
Summer. This is Edmonds and Curly. Joey Edmonds.
Right.
This is weird, because one guy's name is Curly, but you're Curly, Joey Edmonds, and Tom Curly really has straight hair.
Well, actually...
Never mind. Forget it. You met in college at a strange place called...
Oshkosh.
A lot of people joke about the fact that you started at Oshkosh College.
Yes, they do.
Why is that?
Well, I flunked out freshman year, and then after that, I came back in. My mom was putting tractors together to send me there.
I remember. I heard about it. You were a folk singer studying to be...
Well, the folk singing came later.
Okay.
I was studying, I was going to go into anesthesia. You sure you don't want to say that word, Jerry?
You were going to be
anesthetist.
And a what? Why didn't you become one?
Well, I just did not like the idea of just working with bodies. It sounded very boring to me.
Oh, really?
Yes.
And, well, I can think, well, never mind.
All right.
Why are you wearing, speaking of medicine and things, I don't know, why are you wearing these strange outfits?
Well, to become an anesthetist.
What?
I didn't get it either, did I?
You didn't become one because you couldn't say it, right?
You know, right.
All right.
I studied. I'm a registered nurse, for one thing.
Oh, are you really?
Yeah.
I'll sit over here.
Show him your white nylons.
Why are you wearing these things? There must be a reason.
Yes, we thought we'd take you into the realm of a hospital surgical...
A hospital surgical
room.
Rather than tell us about it, Edmonds and Curly...
Hi, students. Let's find your seats up there. As you well know, we have the world-famous neurosurgeon with us this morning, Dr. Richard Gribble. I'm Mr. Edmonds. I'll be assisting him. We have Dr. Williams, anesthesiologist out there. And students, world-famous neurosurgeon, Dr. Richard Gribble.
Morning, people. It's awfully good to be here, of course. Nurse, would you pull the chart down? All right, hand me the pointer. Pointer. Gentlemen and ladies, as you can see before you here, this is the actual cross-section of the human anatomy that we're going to be working on this morning. As you can see here, this is the front right lobe of the forward part of the cortex. You'll see a dark little area right here, this black spot. Moving to the west is a high-pressure system. Now, down here in the subneural norms, there's another little difficulty created by the low-pressure system moving up along the Mississippi River Valley.
Doctor, would you want to scrub up right away?
Well, certainly, yes, of course. Hand me the Mr. Clean. All right, I guess we're ready to go. Gloves, please. Gloves. All right, let us begin, please.
Dr. Williams, pulse rate, please. Pulse rate is 128 over 85. Oxygen, please. Doctor, we're set to go now.
And to the small drill. Power.
Doctor, don't you want to work
on
the head?
Yeah, would you turn him around so I can get at the head? All right, very good. Hammer. Chisel. Scalpel. Sponge. Forceps. Small forceps. Biceps. Forceps. Whoops, we got a bleeder there. clamp quickly. No, that didn't help.
Dr. Williams, give us the pulse rate. Dr. Gribble, the patient's heart has stopped.
Yes, it has. Bring me 300 cc's of adrenaline quickly. We're going into the heart now to stimulate the, whatchamacallit. No, that's not it. Let's see. I pledge allegiance to the... Yeah, there it is. Extracting syringe. Oh, we got a leaker here, too, nurse.
Doctor, give us the pulse rate. Doctor, nothing. Doctor, I think we've lost him.
Increase the oxygen.
Zachary's breathing too fast.
Quickly, nurse, manipulate the bag. Woohoo! The bag! Nurse, all right.
Give us a pulse rate, quickly. Boom.
Boom. Boom. Doctor, we're getting something.
Boom, boom. Boom, 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 boom. Boom, boom, boom.
Doctor's very regular.
Boom, boom, boom.
Would you like a cup?
No,
all right, fine. All right, we're going to close up. Now bring in the suturing machine. All right, suturing machine in position. White thread. Give me the black thread. Let's get a little design in here while we're sitting. Needle. Band-aid. Needle. All right, move the table back, boy. Watch out for the buttonhole. All right, very good. Scissors. All right, take the patient to the recovery room, nurse. Hold it. Scissors. Thank you, nurse. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, very much.
bet you just happen to have something right down there called a record album, huh?
That's right.
Okay. And it's kind of strange writing, but it says just a melody.
Just a melody.
Young Holt Unlimited.
Sure.
Did they tell you it was a train?
Yeah,
was and you bought it, huh? Sure, it's a, whatever they told you. If they told you it's a train.
But spell it the other way out.
There you go. Just a melody, Young Holt Unlimited, with tunes like By the Time I Get to Phoenix, and I Heard It Through the Grapevine, and Light My Fire. Okay, you rested up now? Because that was pretty exciting work you just did.
Yeah, well, you know, I get into a thing like that, and I get myself all worked up and carried away.
You gonna calm down now?
But if we can do the soul for strut.
I'd like to hear it. How about you, huh? Young Hope Unlimited, the soulful strut. Go get it!
Thank you. child came out to wander, caught a dragonfly inside a jar. Fearful that the sky was full of thunder, and tearful at the folly of a star. And the seasons, they go round and round, painted ponies go up and down, kept upon the carousel of time. Can't return, we can only look behind from where we came, and go round and round in the circle game. Then the child moved 10 times round the seasons, over 10 clear frozen streams. Words like, when you're older, must appease him, and promises of someday make his dreams. And 16 springs, 16 summers gone now, cart wheels turn to car wheels through the town. They tell him, take your time, it won't be long now, before you drag your feet to slow the circles down. Better dreams and plenty before the last revolving year is through. And the seasons, they go round and round, painted ponies go up and down, we're kept upon the carousel. Turn, we can only look behind from where we came, and go round and round in the circle
. Since 1961, this nation has been involved in a war. This nation has also been involved in a controversy about that war. I may be wrong, but this may be the first war in the history of this country or any other that is opposed by a significant vocal segment of the population, perhaps a war opposed by a majority. I say perhaps. We're going to talk about that war with two gentlemen who, at the outset, stand at opposite sides of the fence, and we will find out exactly how far apart they are, or hopefully how close together they are. The gentleman to my far right is Mr. Loren Smith. Warren is a Northwestern University Law School graduate, now studying for his bar examination, vice president of the Illinois Young Republicans Association, treasurer of the Illinois Young Americans for Freedom. And Lauren, you state your position on Vietnam, and this is a quote, as a hawk, a not totally extinct bird. Is that word for word? Okay.
That's approximately.
Going to find out why you think the way you do. Gentlemen, between Lauren and I is Garrett Graham. And rather than tell you about Garrett, we're going to show you a bit of a motion picture that Garrett was personally involved in, a film called Greetings. Here's a little bit of it. Now watch your screens.
This is Raymond Tuttle, your Vietnam correspondent, just off the dock train supply room. The trucks you hear in the background are bringing United States supplies to our troops just below the DMZ. Behind me, in the seemingly tranquil swamp, is hidden a highly seasoned squad of Viet Cong snipers, whose mission it is to shoot American convoy drivers in an attempt to halt the smooth flow of supplies to our front lines. To counteract this threat, the United States has deployed a highly trained tactical group whose mission it is to seek and destroy this enemy. I am with one of the members of this elite force today, Private John...
John Rubens, sir. 1st Division, Special Forces, 2nd Air Company.
Well, what are you doing here, Private Rubin?
What am I doing here? I don't know.
Garrett Graham. Go ahead. Go ahead. Garrett was not seen in that segment of the film. However, you appear throughout it as one of the actors. You were telling me about the production of the movie, and very briefly, it's called Greetings, and it was, you had a basic outline, or was it pure improvisation?
Well, the director and the producer had a screenplay, a scenario, and they knew more or less what they wanted out of the film, but we, the actors, wrote the script, if you like. We improvised it, made up the dialogue.
All right, now I think we know where Lauren stands on the war. I don't think there's any doubt. The word hawk, I think, tells us. How would you categorize yourself in a sentence?
Like, well, hawk? Describe yourself in 25 words or less.
It's difficult, but we got a one-line description of Lauren. So
I have one-word descriptions of myself, generally.
Would Dove be where you're at?
Well,
relative
that
to
has
hawk.
That has political connotations. And I, strictly speaking, am not a very political person. I guess my stand is basically humanist or social, if you like.
We're talking about the role of this country in the world. I think it's obvious from what you've said, and tell me if I'm wrong, that you feel our role should be as, and I hate to use the word policeman. Of the world, if you've got a better phrase, use it.
Well,
But is that your concept of our role, internationally?
Not entirely. I think that the concept of our role is the concept of the role of a good citizen in our own society. A good citizen, I think, has the obligation to come to the aid of fellow citizens when fellow citizens are being attacked and have no way of defense. I think what prevails in the world and has always prevailed is a semi-state of anarchy. And those people who do have the power to fend off aggressors and fend off the people who will take advantage of weaker countries have an obligation to do so. When this concerns a vast number of people, I don't think we should intervene every time there's some threat.
But should the United States intervene in such a situation, regardless of the effects on that country? For instance, Saigon being turned into an enormous American brothel.
Oh, that really is not
true. I'm not trying to be sensational.
The other effects would be that Saigon would be turned into a graveyard, and Ho Chi Minh took over. He slaughtered about 100,000 people in North Vietnam in the early 50s.
Well,
this would happen in South Vietnam. Well, part of the problem with the debate is facts and figures, whose figures to believe and whose facts to believe.
Yeah.
But there are certain things which no one, to my knowledge, has disputed. Ho Chi Minh conducted massive purges, and today when teachers in South Vietnam, when editors of local newspapers come out and make any pro-South Vietnam statement or anti-communist statement, they're killed. A policy of genocide is being carried on by Ho Chi Minh. And I think that certainly war is hell. We're always referred as a pro-war or anti-war. I'm not pro-war. I don't think any conservatives or Republicans are pro-war, though sometimes Republicans are referred to as not being politicians either. We're not pro-war, but
we're talking about this war, which is, I think we will all agree, a unique war.
Right.
We're not talking about pro the idea of war. We're talking about our involvement in Southeast Asia, in Vietnam specifically.
Well, even this war. I'm not pro this war, but I don't think there's any alternative. I think if we do not fight this war, we will have a bigger war in Thailand, we will have a bigger war in Burma and Philippines. And this war is not as unique as it's often placed. Put in historical perspective, Korea was very similar in a lot of ways to the war in Vietnam. We've allowed this war to become, to entrap America abroad because we haven't fought it effectively.
So it's purely a military solution from your standpoint that will extricate us from Vietnam?
No, it's not purely a military solution, but part of the solution has to be to tell the communist world that we will use force to gain political objectives.
Now, see, that's just where I disagree, and I just don't buy it. I don't suppose there's any political rhyme or reason to it. As a matter of fact, I'm sure there isn't. But it just seems to me that the United States has taken upon itself an obligation which most of the world's peoples would just as soon they hadn't taken upon themselves. There doesn't seem to me to be any need for the United States to impose its political ethos on a country which up to that point was not a capitalist bastion, which is what they're trying to make it into.
I don't think we're trying to do that. There's a very big difference between what the French did and what the Americans did. The Americans supported President Diem, who was consistently a nationalist, who consistently opposed the French, whereas Ho Chi Minh collaborated with the French during the whole nationalist period. The United States has had one consistent objective. The Kennedy administration did make mistakes. The Kennedy administration did topple Diem, which I think
I think we're going too far back into the past now. True, those were the facts. That was the situation. And again, we're talking about hypotheses about ancient history. We're talking about today. They're giving me that, and unfortunately, we could go on for 7 hours.
Well, I'm sorry, I'm not much of a political theorist. It might have been a better debate if I were.
Well, I don't think it's really a debate as much as I wanted to find out how you two guys stood, and I think we did. I'd like to thank Lauren Smith and Garrett Graham. Gentlemen, thank you.
Thank you.
Flower by James Thurber. If you've never heard it, I think you'll be kind of amazed when you hear it to realize that it was written in 1939. With the help of the Young Holt Trio, The Last Flower. World War XII, as everybody knows, brought about the collapse of civilization. Towns and cities and villages disappeared from the earth. All the groves and forests were destroyed. And all the gardens and all the works of art. Men, women, and children became lower than the lower animals. Discouraged and disillusioned, dogs deserted their fallen masters. Emboldened by the pitiful condition of the former lords of the earth, rabbits descended upon them. Books, paintings, and music disappeared from the earth. And human beings just sat around doing nothing. Years and years went by. Even the few generals who were left forgot what the last war had really decided. Boys and girls grew up to stare at each other blankly, for love had passed from the earth. One day, a young girl who'd never seen a flower chanced to come upon the last one in the world. She told the other human beings that the last flower was dying. Well, the only one who paid any attention to her was a young man she found wandering about. Together, the young man and the girl nurtured the flower, and it began to live again. One day, a bee visited the flower, and a hummingbird. Before long, there were two flowers, and then four, and then a great many. And groves and forests flourished again. The young girl began to take an interest in how she looked. The young man discovered that touching the girl was pleasurable. And love was reborn in the world. The children grew up strong and healthy and learned to run and laugh. Dogs came out of their exile. And the young man discovered, by putting one stone upon another, how to build a shelter. Well, pretty soon everybody was building shelters. Towns and cities and villages sprang up. And song came back into the world. And troubadours, jugglers, and tailors and cobblers, and painters and poets, and sculptors and wheelwrights, and soldiers, and generals, and lieutenants, and captains, and major generals, and liberators. Some people went one place to live, and some went another. Before long, those who had gone to live in the valleys wished that they had gone to live in the mountains. And those who had gone to live in the mountains wished that they had gone to live in the valleys. The liberators, under the guidance of God, set fire to the discontent. Well, presently, the world was at war again. This time, the destruction was so complete that nothing at all was left in the world, except one man and one woman and one flower. When you talk about folk music, there's one name that has to come up. And that is Bob Gibson.
Hey now, Frankie. She was a fine-looking woman, had a man named Johnny Lord. She loved him. She laid down 100 for a suit of clothes. Don't you see them? Walking arm in arm down along Canal Street. Frankie loved Johnny Lord, everybody knows. Hey now, Frankie. Came home one evening just a little bit early. She thought, gonna stop at the corner for a bottle of beer. Well, she sat down. She told her trouble to the fat bartender. Said, tell me, fat daddy, has my Johnny man been here? He said, Frankie. Said, I'm terrible sorry you asked me that question, 'cause you know I'm about as honest as a man can be. Saw Johnny walking down Main, he was feeling no pain. He was slipping and sliding with a girl named Annabelle Lee. Hey then, Frankie. Said, oh no, no, well it can't be so. She said, I know. No, a candy man wouldn't treat me wrong. Well, she sat there. She had a few more beers, she shed a few more tears. She said, I'm tired of getting that mean old runaround. Hey then, Frankie. Got out of the taxi at the corner of Clark Street and looked up. She saw Johnny and Annabelle swinging there. Well, she jumped down. Took deadly
44 pistol, shot her Johnny in the middle of his big affair. Hey now, Frankie, she was a fine looking woman, had a man named Johnny. Lord, she loved him. She laid down a honey for a suit of clothes. Don't you see them walking arm in arm down Long Canal Street? Frankie loved Johnny, Lord, everybody knows. Frankie loved Johnny, Lord, everybody knows.
One thing I think we ought to mention before we go any further, you had a rather personal interest in both of those songs. I don't mean just monetary. You wrote the last one all by yourself?
Yeah, right. And
which is something that you ought to really be proud of. I'll tell you the truth. When I first heard that song, I said, that's got to be a 100-year-old spiritual kind of thing.
Well, I felt pretty old the day I wrote it.
And the other thing, the Frankie and Johnny.
Well, that was one Shel Silverstein and I put together, the cartoonist, for a Playboy magazine.
Who's got another hit song out now about a girl named Sue or something?
Yeah, he wrote that. And he had Unicorn just a few months ago, But he writes some pretty serious lyrics, too. He's written some beautiful things. But this one, I don't know, one day we were sort of clowning around. We decided what the world of folk music needed was another version of Frankie and Johnny. There was only about 30 extant. So we wrote that one,
Great. You've been missing from the folk music scene for a while, and I'll tell you my impressions of Bob Gibson. This is the first time Bob and I have actually met, but I have known of Bob Gibson and admired him for, shall I say how many years? The Kingston Trio era is the time when you first came, at least to my attention. I was a disc jockey at a little radio station, and there was an album of a guy who played a hell of a banjo, and it was Bob Gibson. You don't have the banjo with you today, but...
No.
Okay, you disappeared for a while. You are back on the scene now. Where has music gone in those years since then?
Well, of course, you know, lately they've been talking about a big renaissance of the Nashville and country sound and so on, but I never noticed it really went anywhere, really. Of course, that isn't my natural, you know, genre, the Nashville sound. I don't know exactly where I fall. Somebody said, what kind of music do I do? And I said, well, I'm the leading exponent of Bob Gibson's style.
which is good enough for
the only way I can describe it.
Go ahead. I brought, you have a 12-string, right?
Yep.
And I have a 4-string. That's 16-string.
16-string. Huh? We got it.
You think we could maybe...
That's a quorum.
A quorum, huh? Now, you started off, but I'm going to finish it, remember? We've rehearsed this for, what, 12, 13 minutes there before, right?
Oh, I don't think we had that long.
Not even that long.
It's a song we both know, and it's one that we feel. That's the important thing.
Got a great message, right?
Right.
Anytime.
Going back to where I come from, where the honeysuckle smells so sweet it darn near makes you sick. I used to think my life was humdrum, till I finally learned a lesson that is bound to stick. There ain't no use in my pretending, cause the city sure ain't no place for a guy like me to end in. Going back to where I come from, where the mockingbird is singing in the lilac bush.
Used to go down to the station every evening just to watch that Pullman train come rolling in. And then one night, that great temptation got the best of me and drove me to my life of sin. I took my hat and $14 and I went through all the trouble of the life that always follows when you're rich and hunting romance. Well, my hunting days are over, I can tell you that
I met a gal. Remember her in Kansas City?
In Kansas City.
Ah, she said she'd take me to the hottest spots in the town. But there were things
she had to fix up.
So she took my $14, but there must have been a mix-up. She's been gone since Thursday evening.
Go ahead.
And I got a hunch I'll never see that gal no more when I grow up and have a grandson.
I'll tell him
about my romance and then watch his eyes bug out. But chances are
he won't believe you.
He won't believe me.
Never, never.
And he'll do the same darn thing when he grows up, no doubt. But he can't say
I didn't warn him. What could happen with them city girls? Oh, darn, I'm going back.
I was close to where I come from.
Watch it now.
Where the mockingbird is singing in the lilac bush.
All right, yeah. I'd like to hear that again. I'm proud of that.
Like Miss McFert note there. I had a run too. I'm sorry.
Hey, let's get everybody in on something.
All right.
And the logical one would be the one that we talked about with them before, because
good news, Jerry's coming. We used to save souls with this, the old Gator Horn. We'd get people coming right
the
up.
Old Gator Horn, old wow, Gator. That's saying something. The one with the low ceiling,
that's
right?
That's the one with the floods.
Yeah.
How do you make a flood? Tell you what we need to do. We need to divide the audience up into two sections.
All right.
Fortunately, there's an aisle right down the middle. Did you notice that?
Why don't I take one side of the aisle?
All right. Can you switch sides with me, though?
Glad to.
Okay.
Certainly.
Switch.
Got it. Ready?
All righty.
You're
going
to be the melody.
You're going to take the harmony section.
I'll do our best.
Here's how it's going to go, folks. My crew, right? I got the biggest one.
Okay.
Sing good news, chariots coming, good news, chariots coming, good news, chariots coming, and I don't want to be left behind. Try that. Good news, chariots coming, good news, chariots coming, good news, chariots coming, and I don't want to be left behind. Okay, now hold it. Now, that section over there.
Okay.
Here we go. All you got to do is sing, talk about your good news, chariots coming. Talk about your good news, chariots coming. Talk about your good news, chariots coming. Don't want to be left behind. Do that now. Talk about your good news, chariots coming. Talk about your good news, chariots coming. Talk about your good news, chariots coming. Don't want to be left behind. Now, here's the script. I'll start off with my group. We'll get your group to add in. Now, as soon as both parts are going smoothly, don't get confused by what I do, because I'm going to sing a different song.
Really?
I'll stop you somewhere after we get going a couple times there, and I'll sing a couple of... you know, verse kind of lines. Long white robe at the gate for me, and I don't want to be left behind. Is all you sing back at me each time, right? And we'll start the whole thing all over again.
Clap your hands and snap your
Everybody
feet
understand?
And...
Everybody?
Everybody but me, Bob. But they're the ones who
are
going to
make it. They're with it. Look at the eyes glowing. We can tell they're going to go. Here we go. You start it.
Good news. Chariot's coming. Good news. Chariot's coming. Good news. Good news, chariot's coming. Don't want to be left behind. There's a long white robe at the gate for me. Don't want to be left behind. There's a silver crown at the gate for me. Don't want to be left behind. There's a golden horn at the gate for me. Don't want to be left behind. Good news, here we go. Good news, good news. Chariot's coming. Good news, chariot's coming. Let's hear it. Good news, chariot's coming. And I don't want to be left. Talk about your good news. Talk about your good news. Chariot's coming. Chariots are coming, good news. Chariots coming, and I don't want to be left behind.